We are so excited to be back at Lynn University this year, and we're excited to be back live and in person after a year of online, a year of hybrid. It's so great. Doesn't everybody look amazing?
Everybody, we have all these.
It was
awesome.
Like a whole Vogue catalog out there in the lobby. I love everybody's dresses. We got out of our yoga pants. We put our hair up. It's just so fun to be out and about with each other. It's
and
really
I
exciting.
Love your shoes. And
yes.
So cute.
And my shoes, they say Amore because I love the ladies of Impact 100. And I, yes, I do. And it's even better because I love you. There are more of you to love this year, which is great because we are bigger.
We're better.
And we are stronger when we are all together. So we are so excited tonight. We have 10 finalists, all who have dreams of improving our community. And they're going to tell us how a $100,000 grant from Impact 100 is going to make their vision a reality.
You know, Impact 100 women leverage their donations so that together we make a larger impact than we could alone, thereby empowering our nonprofits to bring much needed services and programs right here to Southern Palm Beach County.
And we have had some awesome membership events this year.
Didn't we have fun this year?
We had so much fun, and we would love to thank all of our party hostesses. They had golf clinics, they had tennis clinics, they had cocktail parties, they had wine tastings, they had gingerbread events. It was just awesome, and we are so grateful for them to planning these events so that we could come and talk about Impact 100 at each of them. We also, yes, thank you. We also want to thank our general sponsors who have partnered with us to be able to bring us things like the kickoff event, the semifinalists and finalists event, and of course tonight's grand awards. We are again grateful to them because with events like this, all of the members are able to come and bring their neighbors, their friends, their colleagues, their family to learn more about Impact 100. We'd also tonight like to thank our media sponsor, Boca Raton Magazine, and our media partner, Multi Image Group. Thank you both so much.
Do you know, Kelly, our biggest thank you goes to you, our members. Thanks to you tonight, we are 727 strong.
Woo!
Because of your contributions, we are able to award 7 $100,000 grants tonight. And the 3 remaining finalists will take home $9,000.
Isn't
that awesome? Are you ready?
I'm ready. Let's do it.
Let's do this.
So tonight, in addition to hearing from your 10 finalists, we are also going to tell you a little bit about Impact 100 and the process that we took to get here tonight. We also are going to be thanking so many people. There are truly a boatload of people to keep the ship in shape and on shore and on track. So we would like to thank many of them too, starting with our co-chairs for the Grants Committee. The selection of the 2022 finalists is accumulation of a year-long effort by our grants committee, led this year by Ingrid Kennemer and Noreen Payne. Yes. We would like to thank them for their leadership and express our appreciation to them, their entire team, the grants focus co-chairs, and their committee for their commitment to the grants process. A little bit about our grants process, if you don't know, to give you an overview. The Grants Committee received 58 letters of inquiry this year from nonprofits, of which 21 advanced to the semifinalists. Those semifinalists then submitted a full grant application and received a 90-minute site visit from the entire focus area team. And from those 21, the 10 finalists you'll see tonight were selected. I was a grant reviewer for 7 years, and it was an amazing experience, and so I can tell you from firsthand experience that they follow a time-consuming and time-tested process to make sure the organizations and projects presented tonight have been well-vetted and can be successfully implemented.
You know, Kelly, the grant reviewers often say this is one of the most rewarding volunteer experiences they've ever had.
Yes.
Tonight, we will hear from 10 5-minute presentations from our finalists. 2 per each of our focus areas, and in the following order: arts, culture, and historic preservation, education, environment and animal welfare, family, and last but not least, health and wellness. Please listen for the impact and sustainability of each project to our community. This next slide defines an impact, high impact grant.
So next, we are going to talk about the Wi-Fi. It's very important because we're going to be voting online tonight. So, some of you have already figured this out because we had some amazing volunteers up there at the membership desk. But we need to make sure, first off, with the Wi-Fi, that your device is connected to the internet. And there are two ways to do that. You can do it with your phone. Your phone might have already connected and you're happy with that connection. Then, if not, you can log on to Lynn's Wi-Fi, and I'll tell you how to do that. You go to your connect to Wi-Fi, and it says Lynn Guest. You're a Lynn Guest tonight. So you click on that, and it may appear that you have connectivity, but you do not, because you have to go accept the terms and conditions. So you have to open a web browser and go to www.lynn.edu and scroll down and click that you accept the terms, and then you should be all set. Sorry. It's in your program, too. Where are you? You're Lynn Guest. You're a guest. You're not actually connected. You just may look like you are. But then you have to go open your browser and go to www.lynn.edu. And then scroll all the way down. We assume that you accept their terms. I'm sure it is terms to protect you.
And once you're on Wi-Fi, check for an email sent from Impact 100 at approximately 5:30 this afternoon. We all sent you another email at 5:30 this afternoon, Tuesday, April 19th. Open the email, scroll down, and click on Vote Now. You will be directed to the Grand Awards 2022 ballot via SurveyMonkey. If you cannot find your email with your personal ballot and you are a voting member for 2022, please wave your hand and one of our volunteers in the orange pashminas will assist you. Don't worry, if you can't start voting, you can always wait until the end of our presentations and vote then. The women with the orange pashminas will be out momentarily. As soon as they do, you can wave your hand. And here they come.
A few questions. Yes. What does that say? Right? You scroll, if you can scroll to the bottom, I think, just is there a scroll to the bottom?
If raise
you keep
your hand.
If you keep going all the way to the bottom, and I think there's something that says, like, accept terms.
Right
oh,
here.
Then you're set.
Right here.
Now you go to the email that you got at 5:30.
Keep
didn't get an email.
Up.
All
Keep
right, ladies. We got some didn't get emails here. There's somebody coming with a pashmina. Hold on. Loading web page. Okay, we're going to get you some help. How many other pashmina ladies are there? Sorry, it can be a minute.
Sarah over here.
Sarah over here, they have several questions too.
Okay.
The not getting an email, we may get you paper ballot if it's the end of the work. I mean, if we really, we have, no? Sorry. It may work. Go to your web browser and see if it's working. But you didn't get an email, you said, right? Okay. It always works when we practice. Yes, she just told me not to. Yes. We might resort to that.
All right. You want to go ahead, Kel?
Yeah. Okay, still raise your hand. Keep raising your hand if you still need help. But in the meantime, I'll tell you what we can do. There are two ways to do it. You can vote as we go along if you've had no problems with your connectivity. If you're having problems while we're talking, or you just prefer this, there's a sample ballot in your program. And if you choose, you can just check them as you go along and take notes in the notes section. And then you can vote at the end of the program. We'll also tell you that after voting for one finalist in each category, and we're going to explain this again, but one finalist in each category, you can vote for the sixth and seventh grants. So you may vote for a finalist you have already voted for or one that you have not voted for yet in a category. So if you happen to like two in one category, you're going to be able to vote for both of them because we have seven to give away tonight.
Please do not stress if you cannot find your email or SurveyMonkey. You can take notes in your program, and you can cast your votes at the end of the presentation. We are now ready to begin the presentation and hear from the 10 finalists for 2022. The first presenter are the finalists from the Arts, Culture, and Historic Preservation Focus Area, which area was co-chaired by Pamela Cornell and Shannon Moriarty. For the Ben Zeighton Center for Creative Arts, their project, Hands Across the Community, please welcome their creative director, Mr. Eli Cecil.
All right. How is everyone tonight? Good evening. I'm Eli Cecil, creative director of Ben Zeighton, and I want you to take a moment with me and close your eyes. I want you to imagine this. Shimmering glass panels intertwine with scrolling metal sculptures, children's handprints, coastal creatures, and other beautiful objects all captured in glass and supported by ornamental metalwork. This makes up a 275-foot-long permanent public art installation that runs down the side of a 14,000-square-foot industrial building in the heart of Lake Worth. Now open your eyes. What you guys have just built in your mind is the Hands Across the Community project. In the 7 years we have been operating, our home, Ben Zeighton, has hosted over 4,500 children who have experienced the magic of glass. Each one of these children were grant recipients from one of our many foundations that support our children's programs at Ben Zeighton. This includes the Mayan Center, which is just two blocks away from our facility. Each of these children were given a chance to work with one of our professional artists and to make their very own piece of glass art. Now, one of our artists, David Mateo, he came from our neighborhood. 6 years ago, he saved enough money to attend a 6-week glass blowing class. After the class ended, he wanted to continue his studies, and we wanted to give him the tools for success. So we created a scholarship. This enabled him to follow his pursuit of art and continue his mentorship with our professional glassblowers. Today, Mateo is not only an asset to our operation, but a working and teaching artist, one who is an inspiration to those in our neighborhood and a testament to our mission. Ben Zeighton has since awarded over $40,000 in scholarships. This project, with help from you and our neighborhood and other community organizations that support us, will engage over 1,500 children, teens, and seniors, along with volunteers to make this permanent art installation in our cultural garden. This sculpture garden will be one open to the public and shine as a beacon of pride to the community that has built it. So I'm going to tell you more about these 45 children that have come through our doors, these 4,500 children that have come through our doors. Another one who's received a scholarship is one teen, Sean, who became captivated with our flameworking studio. He arrived with his mother during one of our visiting artist showcases and became fascinated by a demonstration in flameworking. He immediately connected with the instructor, who naturally invited him to take a class. Sean now arrives every Saturday for a free lesson in flameworking. Soon after his first lesson, his mother reached out. She said that Sean had found his voice. This is a voice that only his immediate family had heard and no one else for many years. He was socially and verbally withdrawn until he became engaged with our center, and we have since watched him blossom into an expressive young man. So just think of the 1,500 kids that are involved with Hands Across the Community, how many more will find their voice? For us, it just goes to show when these kids groups come through, the only thing they love more than participating in the creative process with us is actually taking their finished artwork home and sharing it with their families. But this time around, we want to keep it. We want their art to be shared with our community. The children, the teens, the adults, they will all be hands-on in this creative process. Not only will they design their own glass panel in our fusing department, but they will make a lasting impression of their hand or of one of their favorite objects in our casting studio. The glass panels will be incorporated into the metal framework that is built and installed by the teens who are supervised by our welding department. The project we are proposing will take 2 years to complete, and we will break ground, order materials, and begin to build the framework throughout this summer. Over the next 2 years, we will incorporate all of the glass art that the children groups create. The project will be happening in real time with seasonal updates for all participants and supporters to follow. Upon completion in January of 2024, we will have a public unveiling and a celebration for the community involved. So this landmark project is a beautiful installation that will become a permanent gathering space in our community, as well as a source of pride that is only made possible by the contribution of this Impact 100 grant. The landmark project, like I said, is gonna be a permanent installation. And now I invite you to join us and sign up for a class, join us and take a group tour, and join us and become part of our neighborhood. You can help us fulfill our mission to connect, communicate, and inspire all of these children, teens, and adults who are reaching together with their hands across the community. Thank you. Please visit us at our table for more information and examples of the artwork we do with the kids.
Thank you, Mr. Eli Cecil. The second finalist presenting for Arts and Culture and Historic Preservation is Young Singers of the Palm Beaches for South County Sings for Healing Project. Please welcome their executive director, Ms. Holly Stewart.
Good evening. I want to thank all of you for being here tonight and making a personal investment of your time and your money in our community. I am so excited to be here to tell you the story of Young Singers of the Palm Beaches. We were founded in 2003 by a group of music educators who wanted to create a safe space for children to come together, to learn how to sing, to make friends, and really that wasn't constrained by geography and school budgets or a parent's ability to pay. 19 years later, we're supporting up to 350 children a year at our West Palm Beach PACE program, and we serve another 1,500 children from here in Boca Raton all the way to Jupiter and west out to the Glades through free summer camp and after-school programs located mostly in poor neighborhoods. But we are more than a choir. We're transforming lives through music. I want to tell you the story of a young woman who's very dear to me. She came to us a few years ago in elementary school with a significant stutter that was so severe, she had trouble speaking, and it caused her a great deal of anxiety, and she was very shy, and she rarely spoke. Well, she's now in middle school. She just performed in Carmen with the Palm Beach Opera, and she has the courage to attend a conference for the Southeastern Regional American Choir Director Associations and sing with choirs from across the nation. Our children are learning more than how to sing. They're learning how to make a difference in the community the same way you do. When we learned that the food bank where our choir in the Glades rehearses was running out of food, our families collected over 10,000 pounds of food and $2,700 to make sure other families had access to food. We're also making an impact. Over 80% of our singers are retained from year to year, which means many of our high schoolers were with us in elementary school. Over 90% of our children get promoted to the next grade every year. And even during COVID, 100% of my graduating seniors went on to college, most with financial aid, except one. He turned down a full scholarship studying police work to serve his country as a Marine. This program has graduated an astrophysicist, physicians, teachers, performers, music therapists, and they are all making a difference in the community. Annually, Young Singers produces two concerts at the Kravis Center, but we also perform in over 25 community events to an audience of over 27,000 people. And this is not a recital. Our children perform with the Palm Beach Opera, and we just completed a production with the Palm Beach Symphony that's going to be featured on PBS. And we do all of this regardless of the family's ability to pay. Over 30% of families receive financial assistance, and while some are living at poverty, many are just struggling paycheck to paycheck. 60% of our children identify as a minority, and we provide accommodations for all children with disabilities. We're committed to creating a safe and accepting space for everyone who wants to sing. Our biggest challenge is the sheer size of Palm Beach County. We have South County families who cannot get to our center in West Palm. Our board and funders actually want us to expand next year for our 20th anniversary, and that's where we need your help. The newly constructed Boynton Beach Cultural Center has invited us to start a program there. We just need the seed money. Funds from Impact 100 would help pay for the facility costs and the cost of two instructors. It would give us, starting next August, the ability to recruit 100 new singers who live south of the Lake Worth Road, and then next year bring on another 50, which means by the 24-25 season, we will be completely self-sustaining with grants from the state and county and fundraising from our families. And once you join Young Singers, you are family. One alumni, now an AmeriCorps volunteer doing food sustainability in Colorado, once described what it feels like to perform. You're standing on a stage, and it's dark, and you're there with all your friends, and all you hear is this very muffled applause. And suddenly, there's this silence. And the curtain comes up, and cool air washes over you from the house, and you're looking at 2,000 people who came to see and hear you sing. Now imagine in 2 years, you're sitting in this theater, you're listening to 150 children tell you their voice and their song and their message, and you'll know you made that happen. Thank you very much for your time, your attention, and your commitment to the future.
Thank you, Ms. Stewart. The two finalists from Arts, Culture, and Historic Preservation have made their presentations. Please take a moment to carefully place your vote. If you're waiting until the end of your presentations, you can also mark your vote in your program to save your place. As you ponder your vote for Arts, Culture, and Historic Preservation, we'd like to take the opportunity to thank our board of directors. We are fortunate to have so many women eager to participate and be involved in leadership roles within our impact organization. Our board of directors consists of 27 dynamic women who offer their time and talents for furthering the mission of Impact 100.
Yes, and we'd also like to thank our additional committee chairs, as well as the many volunteers who served on the committees. Our members are responsible for all of our organized membership activities and events. We are a volunteer-driven organization, and each volunteer is an important part of our successful team.
The second focus area to present is education, which was co-chaired this year by Janet Cusio and Ann Henderson. The first presenter for Propel Inc. for their project VirTutor is Mr. Greg Francis, Propel's president. Thank you, Greg.
Good evening. What if I told you that there was a young lady that had a 3.7 GPA at Duke University? And what if I told you that there was a graduating senior in our backyard at FAU that has a 3.8 and secured a job with a Fortune 500 corporation? You would say maybe, wow, that's impressive, but maybe not the most unique thing that you've ever heard. Let me add this to the dynamic. The young lady was virtually tutored from a homeless shelter. The young man never had a bed throughout high school, which was chronicled on CBS News. The dynamics changed. That's just not impressive. It's a flat-out miracle. I'm Greg Francis. I'm the president of Propel, and I'm very proud to introduce and reintroduce, in some cases, VirTutor, which is in its fourth year of existence. We started VirTutor because we ran out of space in our brick and mortar building. Who knew through a pandemic it was going to be so prevalent? However, while we had that pandemic, and believe me, we have an academic pandemic, we didn't skip a beat. And it's really amazing for those that lack literacy, lack fluency, imagine how far behind they would fall if we didn't preempt this virtual program. So what is VirTutor? VirTutor focuses on three core competencies: literacy, financial literacy, and mentorship. Through auditory, visual, and tactile learning. Now, in one of my visual lessons, I asked one of the young men named Michelle to please point out pizza. And he said, "Uncle Greg, pizza and pepperoni." And I was so excited for the fact that he got it, because he was not only understanding the literature, but embracing the culture. VirTutor is a 1-to-2 immersion project, 90 minutes per week for 80 weeks, where we focus on reading, comprehension, enunciation, writing, how to save money, and good life choices. In our first year, we had 15 students who were all reading at least 3 years below their current grade level. At the end of 50 weeks, 14 or 93% were above their current grade level. People need a chance and people need miracles, and we're providing that. Our second iteration, we grew by 6 levels, 90 students. Again, reading an average of about 2.6 levels below their current grade level. I'm proud to say that 81 out of 90, or 90%, at the end of 80 weeks, were reading at or above grade level. Also, the average score on the SAT from this cohort was 1140, 140 points above the national average. We baseline test for 2 hours to see if someone's better visually, auditory, or tactile, and then we match them with someone that is their specialty. It's very well crafted, and it's worked so far. Now we're going really big with 400 students. 99 of our 400 students are living below the federal poverty line in high-risk areas. But to date, not one of our students has been in trouble with the law. They're not living in high-risk areas. They're now living in high-achieving areas. To date, 98% of all scheduled meetings over 4 years was adhered to. And time is running out, so I want to just tell you a quick story. I'm going to the University of Florida next week to go to a graduation. And real quickly, the gentleman said, "Uncle Greg, will you please go to my graduation? I'm graduating in economics. I won't take no for an answer. And when you show up, I want to buy you a hamburger." 4 years ago, he couldn't pronounce hamburger. He said, "When I go into McDonald's, it always means more to me than just a Big Mac." Thank you so much, and please, please partner with me on 400 more miracles. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Francis. The next presenter is education is for Excel Mentoring Network and their project Youth Training and Wellness Project that addresses career training, mentoring, and health wellness. Please welcome their Director of Operations, Ms. Maribel Roman.
Thank you so much. I am so excited to be here. I want to start with a story of a young man that joined our program a little bit over 2 years ago. He was referred to our program by one of our partner charter schools. Nicholas was very disconnected when he came to the program and failing school. We learned that he recently lost his mother and that he was really struggling. After joining the Excel program, Nicholas learned to set goals, manage his time, take care of his health, and he's graduating high school this year. After he was introduced to the trades, he also decided to pursue a career in virtual design construction, and he'll be doing that this May with us. At Excel, we recognize the need for mentoring and guidance for our youth. We know that young people are lacking technical and life skills to succeed in the workplace. And there's also a need for programs to train and attract young people into the construction industry. And there's a great need for skilled employees in the trades. Our proposal addresses those needs through our comprehensive training approach, combining the power of transformative mentoring training and counseling. We do this by group mentoring, individual mentoring. We actually assign a mentor to each one of our youth. We do life skills training and certifications in the trades, like in our mobile training units, in carpentry, electric, HVAC, welding, virtual design, construction. We then provide apprenticeship and employment opportunities through our partners. And lastly, partnering with Family First, we're able to provide for our youth behavior counseling if they need so. We currently serve young people ages 15 to 25 in Central and North Palm Beach County. Youth are referred to us by schools, directly by parents, or another student, or organizations like the YMCA, Powell Sheriff's Office, ChildNet Foster Care, homeless youth programs like Vita Nova, and the Department of Juvenile Justice. So as you can see, we have a lot of students from different places. Our training is available to all young people because the mobile training units makes it possible to travel to schools, organizations, and neighborhoods that would otherwise not have access to this training. With the Impact 100 funding, we will be able to expand our services and serve young people right here in South Palm Beach County. Our plans are to begin outreach in Boynton Beach, Del Rey, and Boca Raton in July, so youth are ready to start training in the fall. The program is ongoing for as long as the youth wishes to remain in the program. We're sustainable because, in addition to grant funding and our fundraising, our corporate partners actually provide funding for us in return to have their logos placed in our mobile training units. Our program approach has proven extremely successful, and we're very proud of these numbers. 98% of the youth that attend our program earn passing grades. 95% of the youth choose to go into the trades, and 80% are referred to apprenticeship and employment opportunities. And the number that we're most proud of, 98% of the students remain with our program for 3 years or longer. In addition to our holistic mentoring and training approach, it is the trust and the bond that our young people form with the staff and our mentors that make our program so successful. There's a young man, Richard, he was referred to Excel by the homeless youth program, Vida Nova. On his first day of training, this young man got so excited when he learned that he can actually get a certification in electric that will make a difference in his life. And he got so excited, he started running back and forth inside the trailer. Another one of the youth in our program, Dallas, came over and whispered something in his ear, and our director Tom asked, what did she tell you? And he said that you will never leave us. And that's how we want to be known, as the organization that will never leave any youth behind. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Roman. You've now heard from the finalists from the education focus area. Please take a moment to cast your ballot, or if you're waiting till the end, to take your notes.
So next, we want to talk about our compliance report. Just so you all know for sure, all $1,000 of your donation goes directly to the nonprofit grants. And as stewards of your impact contributions, we take seriously the outcomes our nonprofits produce. Our compliance committee is an amazing group of women who closely follow our grant recipients' progress through the grant period. They assist the nonprofits in setting measurable goals and outcomes. Something I learned what a measurable goal is, not an aspirational goal, so I'm very proud of all knowing that. And they set definite measurable goals, and they're being used just as proposed. Many thanks to our amazing co-chairs and the compliance committee, the co-chairs Joanne Greiser and Molly Reese.
Our third focus area to present is environment and animal welfare, co-chaired this year by Michelle Bernardo and Carolyn Cassidy. Presenting first for the Marine Education Initiative and their project, the Sustainable Agriculture Education Initiative, please welcome their executive director, Mr. Nicholas Metropoulos.
Hello, my name is Nicholas Metropoulos. I am the Executive Director of Marine Education Initiative. I started our Sustainable Agriculture Education Initiative in January of last year when I saw how the COVID-19 pandemic had exposed multiple vulnerabilities within the U.S. produce supply chain. The majority of the produce that we consume every day comes from California, Arizona, and even across the border in Mexico. For consumers on the East Coast, that means that our produce has traveled thousands of miles before ever reaching our supermarkets or restaurants. Not only is this produce losing its nutritional value, but it means that there is an enormous carbon footprint associated with these greens. Additionally, according to the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, by 2050, we will need to increase the food production by about 70% in order to meet the needs of a global population of 9.8 billion people. Therefore, we must introduce the next generation to sustainable agriculture and new innovations that produce more food to inspire them to pursue careers in sustainable agriculture and help prevent a global food shortage. Currently, there are few hands-on environmental education facilities in southern Palm Beach County. While students are taught environmental education in classrooms, they do not receive an immersive experience as they would in a hands-on interactive setting. Aquaponics is a food production system that combines aquaculture, or the raising of fish, with hydroponics, or the raising of plants in water, to create a symbiotic, environmentally friendly ecosystem. Aquaponics is not new, actually. In fact, the idea of aquaponics came about during the Aztec Empire. While the method of aquaponic growing is not new, the recent technological advancements have allowed us to grow more food with less cost and space than ever before. Aquaponics uses 95% less water than conventional farming, does not pollute our local rivers and lakes, and greatly reduces the amount of fossil fuels used during produce transportation from the west coast of the U.S. Aquaponics also retains 100% of the nutrient-rich water in the farm, which means that there is no agricultural runoff. As we have seen with the red tide outbreak in recent years, agricultural runoff is extremely detrimental to marine environments and has killed more than 600 metric tons of marine life. Since we launched our Sustainable Agriculture Education Initiative, we have educated over 400 students, provided over 30,000 meals, and conserved over 100,000 gallons of water. Yeah, 100,000 gallons. At our aquaponics center in East Boca Raton, we will host school, after school, and summer camp groups twice per week throughout the entire year to educate students 9 to 16 years old about sustainable agriculture. During these visits, students will receive a hands-on experience with testing water quality, discussing water physics, and learning about the nitrogen cycle. Our students will immerse themselves in farming technology and become futuristic farmers looking to optimize crop yield and use minimal resources while farming. When students visit our aquaponics center and plant while learning, they will also help provide fresh, nutritious vegetables to Boca Helping Hand's soup kitchen right down the street. Learning by doing and giving back to the local community is what truly makes this project transformational. With your support, we will make an immense impact in both our local environment and our students' futures. By 2024, we plan to educate over 1,000 youth in our Sustainable Agriculture Education Initiative. Your funds will enable us to bring on a full-time aquaponics director to lead our educational efforts, as well as support further staff development so that we may provide the most immersive program possible for our students. The funds will also allow us to purchase necessary equipment to keep the farm running every year. Your support will also lay the groundwork for our expansion efforts that will soon be underway to promote sustainable agriculture throughout South Florida. In fact, we recently acquired a plot of land in Loxahatchee and are planning to build a 1-acre sustainable farm to provide hundreds of thousands of meals per year throughout the county while also providing environmental education opportunities to local youth. With your help, we can ignite the next generation's interest in future career paths, as well as teach them to grow their own food in their community focused on environmentally friendly farming methods. I hope you will join us in preparing over 1,000 youth in Southern Palm Beach County for the future of farming. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Nicholas Metropolis. The second presenter for Environment and Animal Welfare is Peggy Adams Animal Rescue League for their Project CatSnip South County 2022 project. Please welcome their Executive Director and CEO, Mr. Rich Anderson.
Good evening. My name is Rich Anderson, and I have the privilege of being the CEO at Peggy Adams Animal Rescue League. Thank you so much for selecting us as a finalist tonight. Let me see a show of hands if any of you have adopted or taken advantage of any of Peggy Adams' programs over the years. Okay. When most people think of Peggy Adams, they think about the animal lives that we save each and every day. But actually, our work is just as much about the people of our community as it is about the animals. How many of you are familiar with or have used our Trap, Neuter, Vaccinate Return program? Okay, a few of you, great. This is the program that facilitates the trapping, spaying and neutering, vaccinating and returning free-roaming cats to their homes. These are the cats you see roaming your neighborhood or around a local restaurant or other local business. Those of you who have used this program did so, I know, because you care about the well-being of these cats. Some of them are probably like my good friend George. George is a big, fluffy cat who is loved by everyone on my street in downtown West Palm Beach. George was lucky because our neighborhood had the time and the means to trap him, take him to Peggy Adams to be fixed, and then to pick him up to bring back home to where he lives, bouncing from house to house, neighbor to neighbor, for all of the food and attention that a cat could ever dream of. Tonight, I want to speak with you about our South County residents who feel the same way about the cats in their neighborhoods, but who do not have the money, the time, or even the transportation to take advantage of this very important program. These are underserved residents living below the poverty line, people who love their neighborhood cats, but cannot control an ever-growing population. You see, these cats can have as many as 2 litters of kittens each and every year. Did you know that there are an estimated 250,000 free-roaming cats in Palm Beach County alone? It's a big number. This is actually the biggest challenge pertaining to animals in our county. But it's not just about the cats. It's also about public health, this program. Unsterilized and unvaccinated cats can be carriers of rabies and other diseases that can be transmitted to residents. It's also about protecting the environment, and birds most specifically. A commonly quoted study estimates that 2.4 billion birds are killed by cats every year in the United States. And it's about saving taxpayer money. To be precise, about $400 for every single cat or kitten that, due to overpopulation, ends up at the Palm Beach County government-run shelter, a shelter that each and every one of us has to pay for. Thankfully, Trap, Neuter, Vaccinate, Return, or TNVR, a program we launched here locally in 2010, has proven to be the most humane and the only way to effectively and permanently reduce the number of free-roaming cats. In the past 12 years, we have spayed or neutered 50,000 free-roaming cats, preventing the birth of literally hundreds of thousands of kittens that would have been born on the streets otherwise. Sadly, 8 out of 10 of those kittens born on the street would have died not long after their birth. Many people have never seen a large, out-of-control colony of cats, but many of our neighbors see it every single day, all around them. There are numerous places like this in southern Palm Beach County, from Lake Worth Road south to the Broward County line. These people who love their neighborhood cats, but just wish there weren't so many, simply lack the resources to tackle this problem. Our project proposed for South County would be the first project of its kind in the area, a micro-focused, micro-targeted TNVR effort that will help our neighbors fix the problem once and for all while improving the lives of the cats that they love. Impact 100 support will allow us to hire a dedicated cat trapper and purchase a dedicated vehicle and all of the necessary equipment to work with neighborhoods in need. One that is high on our list is called...
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Anderson. You have heard from the two environment and animal welfare finalists. Please take a moment to carefully cast your ballot. Most of you know that our motto is one woman, one meeting, one vote. The graphic behind me illustrates our model of efficient philanthropy and how your $1,000 contribution is multiplied and magnified. This year, our theme was each one, bring one. And so I'm asking, if you brought someone to a member event, would you please stand? Come on, I know there are a lot of you out there. This is how we continue to grow our membership and strengthen our community. As you know, there's absolutely no volunteer requirement to be a member, but many of our members do choose to participate by joining one of our committees. We are extremely thankful for every volunteer. If you volunteered this year, please stand. You may become a volunteer and learn more about Impact 100 as well as the needs in our community while at the same time getting to know some dynamic and very giving women.
We do have some awesome women involved in Impact 100. So we do promote guilt-free philanthropy, so we are grateful for those of you who choose to write a check and come to our meeting and vote. But we also are eager to have those of you who would like to dig deeper and engage with us on a volunteer basis. So there are several ways to notify to us that you're interested in doing something like volunteering. On the back of your membership form, or the front and bottom of your membership form, I think, there's boxes you can check for different committees, and on the back are the descriptions. Also, when you finished after you're voting, on the electronic ballot, you'll see places where you can also check off to indicate what committees you're interested in. And we will contact you if you fill something out by the committee chair. Keep in mind, some of these you'll be contacted soon. Some things happen in the summer, some in the fall, some in the spring, so we will get a hold of you. Also, if you'd like to volunteer, we'd like to introduce our volunteer coordinator, Ellen Elam, who I think is here. Ellen, can you stand up or wave? Or she's here. Whoa, in her, see, our volunteering in her orange pashmina. Yes. So, Ellen is going to be at the volunteer table in the lobby. That's another thing you could do to answer any questions you have. Also, if you don't want to be on a committee, but you sort of want to be in an as-needed basis, ad hoc kind of, if we need you and you're available, that kind of a volunteer, please just put grand, if you're doing it electronically, do grand awards special events, and out in the lobby we have a special form for those people, and we can call you, and if you're available, that would be great. We'd love to have you.
Thank you, Kelly. Now for our presentations from the fourth focus area, family, co-chaired by Kelly Ligori and Janine Malusnik. Our first presenter in family is Friends of Foster Children for their Kinship Care and Connections program. Please welcome their executive director, Martha Putnam.
Good evening. My name is Martha Putnam, and I am the executive director for Friends of Foster Children. We are a small agency, just 7 women, but we are dedicated to changing our broken foster care system one problem at a time. Each and every day, we strive to live our mission of fostering happy childhoods, and I'm honored to share with you this evening our proposal, Kinship Care and Connections. 8 years ago, my husband Vince and I became a traditional foster family. We took over 30 hours of required educational classes. We prepared our home, our four biological children, and our hearts to take in a foster child. When she was 3 years old, Paige came to live with us, and eventually we were able to adopt her. Ours is a success story, not only because we had the education, but an entire support system ready to help us on this new and daunting journey. Children entering foster care that are placed with relatives or close friends is called kinship. Miss J is a 29-year-old single career woman who lives in Boca. She got a call recently asking if she would take her two nieces and nephew into her home. She was thrust into the foster world simply because she said yes to family. She did not have the advantage of education or preparation prior to that fateful phone call. Having never been a parent before, it didn't take long for her to become overwhelmed trying to navigate the confusing child welfare system and raising three little ones. But with your support, her story can have a successful outcome as well. Our high impact proposal includes a two-pronged approach that addresses both the care and connections for these families to survive and thrive. Foster children can only be left in the care of adults that have passed background screenings. This makes a night out extremely difficult. Just calling a babysitter is not an option. The first arm of our initiative is expanding and enhancing the Southern Palm Beach County Foster Parent Night Out. Joining with our partners, Trinity and Avenue Churches, volunteers are recruited and background screened. We will be expanding Foster Parent Night Out from once a month to twice a month, doubling the opportunity for the caregivers to practice self-care without the worry and stress of finding appropriate child care. Imagine they can drop their kids off and have 3 hours to do whatever they want, a date night, grocery shopping in peace, or even going home and taking a nap. For the kids, it includes dinner and some fun age-appropriate activities. Over the course of this grant, we will serve over 700 children. The second arm of our initiative is the creation and implementation of the Kinship Connection Education Series. This is essential. These families deserve the chance to flourish, and they will do so by being equipped with relevant foster topics, parenting classes, and healthy communication workshops. Kinship 101, 201, 301, and 401 will be offered quarterly. Each curriculum is 4 sessions, 2 hours each class. The pilot Kinship Connections curriculum will be hosted on the campus of Trinity School in Delray. We anticipate serving close to 200 adults. In order to reduce as many barriers as possible, while the caregivers are in class, we will offer babysitting and tutoring help. Finally, the kinship caregivers will take pre and post tests so we can measure their increase in knowledge and lowering stress levels. Right now, there is no educational program for kinship caregivers, but together, we have the opportunity to be true innovators, creating something brand new, a comprehensive educational program tailored to these kinship caregivers. Since the curriculum will be created on slides, it is easily adaptable for future revisions. And finally, due to the technology in the classroom where the program will be held, we have the capacity to record the classes, creating a sustainable video library of education for years to come. The goal is to make a difference in the lives of our kinship families, equipping them with knowledge and opportunities for self-care, thereby transforming both this generation and the next. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Martha Putnam. The second presenter for family is the Unicorn Children's Foundation for their Family Navigator Program. Please welcome their Chief Executive Officer, Ms. Sharon Alexander.
Thank you so very much. In Palm Beach County, there are more than 30,000 children affected by special needs. Today, I would like to share a brief story about one of them, and how you can help many more like her. Masha was born in Ukraine and blessed to be adopted by a local family here in Boca who fell in love with her despite her obvious challenges. When they met her, she was nearly 4 years old, weighed 22 pounds, and didn't speak. She looked like an 18-month-old baby. Her parents knew it was going to be an uphill battle, a challenging journey where both parents and child would have to navigate the complexity of multiple systems of numerous doctors, therapists, specialized educators, countless appointments and services, and endless stress for the parents as they tried to do the best for Masha. Her parents engaged in the pursuit of appropriate interventions and support through a network of friends and the word of mouth experiences from other families with similar challenges, and ultimately found Unicorn Children's Foundation. Unicorn is headquartered here in Boca Raton, and we have served special needs families for over 26 years. In 2015, we surveyed more than 450 local parents, families, and stakeholders, and they told us they need three things. First, to bridge the gaps between program and service providers to improve outcomes. Two, to reduce stress for families and caregivers. And three, to improve access to resources for families, especially in communities of color. UCF's Family Navigator program will meet those needs at no cost to families in South Palm Beach County. From our headquarters right here in downtown Boca Raton, we will expand this project to facilitate the complex journey for 1,300 children and families with young adults with developmental differences. First, we will develop a framework for comprehensive individual success plans and family success plans. These plans will help children and families plot their needs and dreams over the course of their lives and include tools for tracking outcomes which currently do not exist. Personalized to their unique circumstances, these plans will cover education, recreation, employment, financial stability, transportation, housing, and mental health. Then we will hire a case manager to work directly with children and families and help them use their plans to develop long-term goals and short-term measurable benchmarks. Specific to each family's needs and plans, the case manager will help connect them with existing community resources to support their goals, including local providers, as well as inclusive programs offered through our Unicorn Connection Center and our Early Intervention Parent Coaching Program for children with autism. We will also help them navigate the complex system, including Medicaid, IEPs, Social Security, and more. We will facilitate support groups and educational workshops on relevant topics. Finally, we will create and connect family-to-family mentors to help those just beginning their journey to learn and build connections with those who know it best, other families like themselves. After 1 year of these activities, we will ramp up marketing and community outreach to specifically target communities of color and families in low-income zip codes to strengthen the support of historically marginalized and underserved populations. With this personalized, targeted support, we will help these children and their families reach their greatest potential. By working with them to establish clear goals, access local resources, and navigate the complex web of special needs, we will bridge the gaps, reduce their stress, and give them the tools they've been asking for nearly 10 years. Our work is supported by our many corporate and foundation partners, and we have started a fee-for-service model with an income-based sliding scale for our instructional and social classes. We have also launched two social enterprises that will generate revenue that can be reinvested into our programs. We are laser focused on ensuring that this project is sustainable and its impacts will last for many years into the future. Now, remember I told you about the child, Masha? I would like to share an update on where she is today. She is a graduate of Lynn University, a junior board member at Unicorn Children's Foundation, a trained and certified barista at our Special Perks Cafe, an entrepreneur and a vendor with developmental differences and inner beauty continue to
today, personally understand the need for such a program, and wish they had access to a comprehensive program like this earlier in their journey. Thank you for your kind consideration.
Thank you, Ms. Alexander. You've now heard from the Family Focus Area finalists. That's a mouthful. This is tough this year, right, Kelly?
I know, everything. Every category has got amazing people.
Tough categories.
I know. I also have a small PSA. Someone has lost a silver cell phone, an iPhone. So if you happen to have I have done this before, grabbed someone else's phone and then had two in my purse. So if somebody else... My family's like, how could you possibly do that? I'm like, it's easier than you think. They all look the same to me. So if you all could just check around here or whatever and make sure that nobody has an extra silver iPhone, that would be greatly appreciated. If not, they'll continue looking elsewhere for it, but I was asked to ask, so sorry.
No problem. So as you're casting your ballot for the family focus area, I want to tell you about some special members of our team. Our membership committee, co-chaired by Nicole Mugavero and Lisa Warren. Worked tirelessly to educate our community on this amazing organization. Thanks to them and to you, this evening we are granting $727,000 to nonprofits serving Southern Palm Beach County.
Woohoo! I think that deserves some applause. So, though tonight this marks the end of our 2022 grant year, it is the celebration of the beginning of our 12th year. And we already have 100 women who have paid.
Wow.
Thank you. Awesome. Yes. So I may say this a few times, but this is kind of good for us. So at the end of voting on SurveyMonkey link, there will be somewhere where you can renew your membership now. And Holly always likes to say it's like the dentist. They tell you it's your birthday, it's time to have your dental appointment. What we would love is for you to know, like, it's the grand awards. It's time for me to renew for next year. That would be ideal for all of us. And then we wouldn't have to bother you all year to make sure that you're joining us in membership. There are three different membership options. We want to let you know you can pay tonight either by check or credit card. You can pay online after your ballot. We'll talk about this later, but it'll give you an opportunity. But also you can pay online by credit card whenever. We also now have a payment plan you can use, or you can pledge to pay sometime later in the grant cycle. If you do choose to pay online, note that some of you have asked for this. We now have a reoccurring payment button, so that if you know you're in and you're in and you're always going to be in, then push that button and it'll charge your credit card every year. Also, for those of you who use a donor advised fund, they also have a feature that gives you a recurring donation you can use. So those are great options.
As an additional bonus, when you turn in your completed membership form tonight, you will be entered in one of four drawings. If you've already paid and joined for next year, you're also already in the drawing. Everyone who pays their 23 membership this evening will be entered in a drawing for a three-day, two-night stay for two guests at the Hutchinson Shores Resort and Spa in Jensen Beach, Florida.
Which sounds really relaxing right now. I think that'd be great. Also, for Total Wine, a wine tasting for up to 20 guests, so you can grab your entire row and get to know each other better at Total Wine.
A wine tote with two bottles of wine and a True Food Kitchen gift card.
And an Impact 100 PBC Spirit Basket, so you can be an official cheerleader for Impact 100.
All of these drawings will be held immediately after the announcement of the Grand Award recipients.
So if you do plan to pay for your 2023 membership this evening, you can pay at the end of your voting via SurveyMonkey, or the volunteers at the membership table in the lobby would be happy to take either a check or a credit card tonight, and all this will make sure that you are entered into the drawing to win these amazing prizes. Also, if you are one of our favorite 100 members who've already renewed for 2023, your name's already in the bowl, so you don't need to worry, you're entered to win already.
Our fifth and final focus area to present this evening is health and wellness, co-chaired this year by Diane Alprin and Catherine Metzger. Our first presenter for Love Serving Autism for their Serving with Heart in South Palm Beach County program please welcome their founder, Ms. Lisa Puglis LaCroix.
Good evening. Serving with heart on and off the tennis court. Health, education, adaptive, recreation, therapies. Heart. Health. Did you know that 1 in 44 children are diagnosed with autism by the age of 8? They are 3 times more likely to develop chronic health conditions in their lifetime. Education. Love Serving Autism educates the community about autism awareness, acceptance, and inclusion for neurodiverse individuals. Adaptive, we train certified tennis professionals on how to modify and adapt tennis programming. Recreation, we provide specialized therapeutic tennis instruction to children and adults with autism in 28 locations in Florida, 7 out-of-state locations, and we currently have 5 requests internationally for programs. Therapies. 40% of individuals with autism are non-speaking and non-verbal. The communication skills they learn on the tennis court will carry over into their school, vocational, home, and community settings. Families raising children with special needs experience many challenges, including financial, access to multiple therapies, and low-cost, reduced, and free recreational programming. What are the benefits of adaptive tennis? Tennis teaches hand-eye coordination, fitness, communication, and life skills. It is also a wonderful opportunity for a strong parent support network. Autism is not an end-of-life diagnosis. It is just the beginning of the game. A few years ago, I received a very special phone call from my mom who said, "Hi, Miss Lisa, you're my son's speech therapist at the Palm Beach School for Autism. His name is Andrew. And the doctors are very concerned about him because of his weight gain, and he loves to play video games after school. He really doesn't have much social interaction. I heard about your organization, Love Serving Autism, and I would love to register him, but I just don't know if he would come out to tennis and try." Well, I encouraged her to participate in tennis and to sign him up, and Andrew did so well, I'd have to say he aced the program. In 1 year, he lost 30 pounds. He demonstrated much improved self-confidence, and I really firmly believe that tennis gave Andrew a voice. Your Impact 100 Palm Beach funding will support 4 program locations for Love Serving Autism, including Boca Raton, Delray Beach, Boynton Beach, and the Palm Beach School for Autism in Lake Worth. We currently serve 100 youth ages 5 to 18 with 4 certified tennis professionals in those locations. With your additional funding, we will serve over 400 youth with autism and 25 certified tennis professionals, including a heart team with speech, occupational, physical, and behavioral therapists in the 4 locations across a 2-year period starting in May 2022 and finishing in May 2024. Our goal is for 80% of participants to demonstrate measurable improvements in communication and fitness, a fine motor, gross motor, and tennis skills. $25,000 of the grant funding will provide scholarships for 100 children with autism in Southern Palm Beach County to play tennis. With your support, we will be able to double the number of youth with autism impacted. Additional funding will support our big vision of Love Serving Autism to open an inclusive indoor therapeutic tennis and recreation center in Southern Palm Beach County to serve children and adults with autism and developmental challenges. Thank you, Impact 100, for your time and support. And as for the student who lost 30 pounds playing tennis for 1 year, he traveled with Love Serving Autism to New York to play tennis on Stadium Court 17 at the U.S. Open. Let's continue to ace serving others together in our community with love. Thank you and have a great evening.
Thank you, Ms. Puglis LaCroix. The second presenter for health and wellness is the Soup Kitchen for their project Lift Up. Please welcome their Chief Executive Officer, Ms. Marlene Mejia.
Good evening, and thank you so much for recognizing the Soup Kitchen in this incredible group of applicants. I'm in awe. Over 39 years ago, three women, Gwen James, Veronica Payne, and Bee Brown, just like any trio of you sitting right here, came together to discuss a need they identified in this community. The hunger and overall isolation of the migrant worker families. They sat together, pooled their resources and talents, and they got to work believing they can make an impact. The Soup Kitchen is still a reflection of that original vision, serving those in need without question or judgment. Tonight, I am here to ask for your support of our newest program, Lift Up. This program seeks to support teens and young adults who have aged out of the foster care system, ages 18 to 25, in Southern Palm Beach County. At 18, these young adults, who are really just children, must transition from their homes. Most leave with little more than a garbage bag filled with their belongings. We see these kids in the Soup Kitchen as they come in for meals, seek safety from homelessness and exposure, or deal with health issues. Without intervention and support, less than 50% will graduate from high school, triggering unemployment and homelessness. The pandemic has only exacerbated things. What we know is very simple. First, no one can make a major life decision when they're hungry. And second, being kind and free of judgment is the best way to let people see how you can help. These young adults will not be receptive to help if they do not feel safe. This is at the heart of everything that we do at the Soup Kitchen. The Impact 100 grant, if we are so fortunate to be awarded, will allow the Soup Kitchen to get the Lift Up program off to an impactful start. In May and June, we want to welcome the first group of 10 to 12 men and women into the program to meet two times a week for approximately 2 hours, including a meal together. The focus and theme of each week will be developed by our program director with input and feedback from the Soup Kitchen's leadership, volunteers, stakeholders, referral partners, and our Lift Up participants. Initially, we will offer a structured curriculum for training in the culinary food services. There is no better place to learn than our exceptional kitchen from our chef, who is a credentialed instructor. He, along with a service team, can provide our participants with a certified training in cooking skills, and at the completion of the course, we hope to help place participants in secure jobs with local kitchens, businesses, and organizations. Past participants continue advancing their skills and partnering with newbies as peer mentors. Our goal is for this program to be dynamic, linked to a plan with measurable goals and objectives, but also able to utilize flexibility and be responsive to the needs of the young adults engaged at that time. For example, if their housing is not safe or secure, then talking to them about healthy lifestyles is not going to make an impact. We need to allow the space and freedom for this program to address the potential chaos in their lives first, so we can help them find success in small accomplishments that lead to stability. Our projected budget is $117,000 for the first 12 to 18 months of Lift Up. Close to 50% is made up of expenses related to food, meals, transportation, and materials to help the participants. We do not pretend that every story will be a success story. We know that there will be challenges, but isn't it our role to offer the program, look for those young men and women that need someone to invest in them and help? The spark for Lift Up was ignited when Marsha, a 19-year-old, came seeking food. She had aged out of foster care, was quickly homeless and using drugs, but wanted desperately to improve things. She would be at our kitchen each day helping to unload food donations and was grateful for a meal in return. Our volunteers found more ways they could help her, and with support, she stopped using, reunited with a family that had fostered her years before, and worked hard to become one of our drivers for donation pickups at the Soup Kitchen. There are so many more Marshas in our area, and there is no doubt in my mind of the impact our Lift Up program will have, not only on the participants, but the whole community as we shift their mindset from surviving to thriving. We know that this
Thank you, Ms. Mejia. You've now heard from the two health and wellness finalists. Please take your time to vote carefully.
Okay, so we're now going to talk about the ballot. It's a little bit about the voting process. So on SurveyMonkey, if you haven't already opened SurveyMonkey, we're going to open SurveyMonkey. And your voting process begins in your letter. Hope for those of you who received your letter, hopefully we've taken care of those that you have not. It begins with an orange box that says Vote Now. So in your email, you click Vote Now, and then it's going to take you to a ballot. So when you are finished voting, and we're going to give you a minute, Holly's going to explain some more about the voting, but when you do finish voting, at the bottom there's another Vote Now button. So I just want to let you know that once you press that Vote Now button, for the second time, because you do it in the email and then you do another one at the end of your ballot, your vote is going to be securely transmitted and your ballot is going to be cast. So the next window that pops up is a payment window for next year, because we're encouraging you to go ahead and pay for next year if you would like to do that. But we do want to know that that is just something we hope you take advantage of. It is absolutely not mandatory. You do not need to renew for next year in order for your vote to be counted. The minute you hit Vote Now, it's off in cyberspace being counted with everyone else's, and you can rest assured that it is there. And you will also, if you're you'll receive a confirmation email from SurveyMonkey that your vote has been cast, but we just wanted to let you know that when you push that button, you're going to see that membership information. That's just a convenience that has nothing to do with your vote being cast. Your vote's cast the minute you push it.
So you'll vote for the first five grants in the same manner as we did last year, one grant per focus area. You will vote for a sixth and seventh grant by choosing either your overall top choices, even if you already voted for them in one of the five focus areas, or you may vote for projects that you did not vote for in a focus area. The finalists with the most votes for the sixth and seventh grants that are not recipients of one of the five focus area grants will be the sixth and seventh $100,000 grant recipient. No finalist will be awarded two grants. The finalists with the highest number of votes in each focus area, as well as the sixth and seventh, will be awarded a $100,000 grant, and the remaining finalists will each receive $9,000. If you happen to do a hand ballot, which we are discouraging, you have to have printed and signed your name or your ballot will not count. To recap, the 2022 nonprofit finalists in order which they are presented is on the screen. Thank you to all of the finalist presenters this evening and best of luck to everyone.
We are also happy to announce that in addition to the votes that are cast here tonight, over one-third of our membership already voted either by online or by mail, and those votes are being incorporated into the tally tonight.
In a few minutes, we're going to gather again in the lobby to share celebratory drinks while our votes are being tabulated, but before then, we'd like to share some special news.
Yes, after this evening's awards, this is very exciting, Impact 100 Palm Beach County will have awarded 48 $100,000 grants.
That's awesome. In our,
and we will have cumulatively given over $5.25 million to 88 local nonprofits. Can you believe that, Holly? I mean, that's like, I'm just, the power of giving as one is pretty powerful. Right?
And there's no sign that they're slowing down.
Yes, thank you all for being the key to those incredible achievements.
We also are excited to announce that last year we started a campaign for the purpose of enabling Impact 100 Palm Beach County to build our internal structure, increase the capacity of our volunteer-led organization, and grow our membership, as well as our outreach to nonprofits. We aptly named the campaign Dream Big, which is what we ask our nonprofits to do. We are honored to thank those who immediately answered the call to ensure the sustainability and longevity of our impact chapter, as you see on the screen today. Thanks to our Dream Big donors, we were able to hire our first administrative director, Anne Boudichois.
And we have a few unsung heroes, we will call them, that we'd also like to thank tonight. How about those legacy leaders? The legacy leaders led by Karen Sweetapple and Susan Duane. Yes. They've pulled together some of our past leadership and have been there to support us in any way that we need them, and we're so grateful for that. Also, a second big thank you to Susan Duane as well for again organizing and implementing our voting procedure via SurveyMonkey. That's no small task.
Kelly, there is somebody very special who happens to be here tonight in person, which I'm thrilled that they're here. For many years, she has input all information for our members into our database, mails the tax donation letters, and delivers all types of information to our committee chairs and board members. We like to call her our Donor Perfect Queen. Please join us in extending a huge round of applause for Nancy Tomlinson. In June, I will be handing over the presidency to Kelly Fleming.
Thank you. And following me will be Janine Morris and Kimberly Bolt as co-presidents-elect. Very grateful to have them. And thank you, by the way, so much for your leadership for the past year. Holly's been an amazing leader.
Thank you, Kelly.
Our Impact chapter is really fortunate to have these exceptionally talented and dedicated leaders to continue the mission of making an impact in our community. Thank you, Kelly, Janine, and Kimberly.
And Holly. We thank you so much for your support and participation this evening. Especially, we want to thank our Grand Awards Committee, which this year is co-chaired by Renee Fader and Sarah Doyle. Please join me in thanking them for this amazing evening. It's a lot to put us all together.
Did you all know that Impact 100 has an app? If you haven't already downloaded the app, I encourage you to do so. On the app, you'll be able to see all of our events, RSVP for the events, communicate with your committee chair, and connect with other Impact 100 members.
This is a great idea, by the way. This is really easy to get all kinds of information on. So, but in closing, we just want to thank you so much for your participation. Impact 100 is about all of us coming together to give as one, and it's a powerful source for good in our community. All of the people, our community is so much richer and greater for all of you coming together to work together for this organization. We are, in fact, now one of the biggest private funders in Palm Beach County, which I think is a pretty amazing accolade considering the size and wealth of our county. So we are making a big impact in organizations and helping those organizations make an incredible impact in the lives of people in our local community. And I hope that you feel as proud as I do about the work that we do together. It takes every one of us, and it is the most amazing thing, the one multiplied into 727 this year.
There's Nancy Tomlinson. I was looking for you.
She's always hiding over there.
Throughout this next year, when you read updates on our grant recipients, we hope you'll acknowledge your part in their successes and that you'll be moved by every life that is touched. Our $100,000 grant recipients will be announced in the lobby in approximately 20 minutes. While we wait for the votes to be tabulated, let's move into the lobby to start our celebration.
Woo!
Let's get it started. Let's get it started in here. Let's get it started. Let's get it started in here. Let's get it started. Let's get it started.
everybody, everybody, let's get into it. Get stomping, get started, get started.
Come on, y'all.